a lot of people, they destroy the person thinking that they are destroying the sin.
Yeah.
But then what you need to understand that when you come to the person, recognize that this person is created in the image of God, yet this person did this.
Exactly.
Let's deal with the action and let's rescue the person.
That's right.
Don't destroy both. Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Jesus King podcast. Hopefully you're doing well. I'm here with Abe. How you doing, Abe?
I'm good, man. I'm good.
Good to see you, bro. Really love you, man. Good to do ministry with you.
Always.
Today we're talking about church discipline.
Yeah.
Could you give us a bit of an introduction to the topic that we're talking about?
I think it's an important thing now because we have a very hypersensitive culture.
Okay.
And what's happened is because our culture is very sensitive about being confronted with like any issue right now. And I have a bit of a background in, you know, therapy and that kind of thing. When you confront people about their issues or about the way that they're acting, they get very sensitive. They get withdrawn, especially today.
Mm-hmm.
We're not really cultivating a culture where people can handle truth. You know, they just back up, they back down. That's permeated into the church. One of the things that's happened, especially if you've been in ministry for a while, you'll notice people from other churches coming to your church and they're talking about, oh, that church was very judgmental and whether they kicked them out or that we didn't feel welcomed anymore. And then you dig deep and you talk to the pastor and then you realize there was actually major sin in that person's life that they were confronting. And they didn't like the fact that it was being confronted. And so either they left or they were told, look, I think you need to, you know, maybe part ways and you can't congregate here anymore because of this sin in your life, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think it would be a good thing to maybe unfold and unpack whether church discipline is a biblical model, whether it's biblical and how it should be, kind of what's the method that
cool,
is biblical.
Cool. Yeah. And it does definitely feel like, you know, someone is escaping responsibility when they move from one church to another, church hopping. In that sense that I'm going to a new group of people, they don't know my past, they don't know my current spiritual life. And, you know, they don't need to. If I keep my life private, they're not going to ask questions.
That's right.
And I'm going to keep on doing what I like to do.
Mm.
And yeah, I'm still having some fellowship. And that's a big problem because people want the blessings of a church.
That's right.
Right? That you have a Christian community, but at the same time, they want to enjoy their sin.
Yeah.
And you have a good example of the person that was sleeping with his stepmom in 1 Corinthians 5.
Yeah.
And Paul is calling the elders to excommunicate him, take him away from the Christian community for him to understand the burden of his sin.
Yes, sir.
Because if this person is experiencing the grace, the love of the church
while he's in sin,
then he's basically wanting to have best of both worlds kind of thing.
Yeah.
It's
like if I'm hugging my son and I'm encouraging him after he's just yelled at his mum, I'm encouraging that behavior, you know?
Yeah,
so
true.
So there's wisdom. And the whole idea of this is very different to Catholic excommunication. Mm. So before, I think this is one of the reasons why a lot of churches, especially Protestant churches, they don't want to excommunicate anymore. It's because of the abuses of it in the Catholic Church in history. And there were abuses, so we could see that, you know, they'd excommunicate someone just for speaking, you know, a different language or at home, like instead of speaking, let's say they were speaking English or instead of Latin or whatever, they'd excommunicate them.
Mm-hmm.
You're no longer a part of church. So there were a lot of abuses because they were telling people, you know, basically Pharisaic laws, right? You have to hold our traditions, otherwise you're not welcome here, right? That's not a biblical model. The biblical model is you are welcome here so long as you are adhering to the principles of Christ, in Christ alone, right? And it's not really about our own traditions and our own personal convictions. It's about What does the word of God say? And how are we all looking to glorifying him by obeying and walking in that? Right?
Cool.
Yeah.
So, when it comes to church discipline, what would you encourage a church goer, right? Because you might not be in the leadership, right? But as a Christian, you still have responsibilities towards each other,
Yeah.
right? What would you encourage your church goer to be like? Okay, you have a responsibility, you have a part in it.
Yeah.
Okay, you gotta do your job right. Because sometimes you can go to the other side where you're overbearing
That's right.
and the person is struggling, looking for repentance, but we're not showing any
Yeah,
understanding. And
no
therefore, we're
compassion.
like,
Yeah, of
you know what?
course.
If you didn't stop that sin today,
Yeah,
you're
that's it. You're
out.
out. Yeah.
So,
There's no grace there. Yeah.
yeah. So how would a Christian navigate this?
Again, we have to speak hypothetically because we can't speak to every single person's situation. So we don't know exactly what church you're in. It could be a church that's full of spiritual abuse. So we're not speaking about that. Let's say your church is a church that has a solid pastoral governing. Your leaders are strong, they're spiritual, they care for you, so you have that solid leadership, right? Your call as a believer and as a member is to submit to their authority because they care for your soul. Right? So the idea of the governor in the church, the idea of the leadership and the elders in the church is to watch over your soul. So if they see that you have fallen into sin, or if they see that you're walking a path that is dangerous, it is their responsibility to confront you. Now they should do it in compassion and gentleness if you're ignorant about it. And they'll be like, hey brother, let's go have a chat. A lot of pastors, they'll take a member out for a cup of coffee, casual, make them feel comfortable and then approach it, So there should be a spirit of gentleness and humility while doing it, but nonetheless you need to confront certain things. Now, as a member who's submitted to that authority, to their authority, their spiritual authority over your soul, they're watching over your soul as a under shepherd of Christ, you should take and be like, well, they're caring for me. They want me to do my best in Christ. They want me to grow in Christ. So, yes, it hurts that I've been confronted about this thing in my life, but I'm gonna walk towards the goal of being edified and grow spiritually. That should be the attitude. Now, it's not always like that. You can feel discouraged about it. You're gonna feel discouraged about it. I've been confronted for certain things that I wasn't unaware of. And it feels very discouraging for a day or two, but you come to Christ and you realize that person there is really trying to seek my best spiritually,
But not to have those emotional attachment to certain things.
to certain, even certain remarks that like, oh, I can't believe he said that, and you bear that resentment for a long time. It's like if you have a personal trainer at a gym and he's telling you, dude, I saw you at Macca's scoffing down that Big Mac. You can't be doing that, man.
See, this is why I don't have any personal trainers.
Yeah, it's like he wants your best,
Yeah.
right? You're there, you've come under that guy's training and leadership so that you can get fit, so that you can be healthy, right? It's the same thing in church. Why am I using this example?
Yeah. All right. I get that. So you're talking about solid leadership.
Yeah.
But sometimes a church goer might go to a place where it feels like my leadership can see the sin, right? It's open there, but no one wants to confront that person,
Okay. Yeah.
right? And I feel like
We're in first Corinthians territory now.
yeah, I have this personal conviction where I'm like, this shouldn't be happening to my brother, to the church, and the leadership are not doing their role right. So how can, hypothetically speaking, how can we work something out? Like in wisdom.
So in the wise way is to look at Matthew 18.
Okay.
So Jesus does speak about certain things. He's speaking in that context about a personal sin against you by a brother. So he says, and so we take the principle. So if your brother sins against you, bring a person, talk to him directly. And if he doesn't relent, if he doesn't repent, then what do you do? You bring someone else
Yeah,
as a
two or
witness, two
three.
or three as witnesses. If still he does not repent and he doesn't think he's done anything wrong, and we're talking about like sin against you. This is a clear disobedience in the sight of God
Yeah.
that he's done towards you. This is not like something that, oh, he offended me because, oh, he's about personal convictions or something like that. This is a clear sin. Then bring two or three. If he doesn't repent, then what do? You bring it to the whole church.
Yeah.
And then at that point, if he doesn't repent, then it is an excommunication kind of situation where, look, you're going to have to leave the church. And the whole point of the excommunication, it's not supposed to be a permanent thing. It's supposed to be a temporary season that they feel the weight and burden of the sin, they come to repentance, and they're brought into the fold. It's like 1 Corinthians 5, the man sleeping with his father's wife, he falls into sin, and then Paul the apostle says, get him out. You can't. That this is terrible. This is even the Gentiles don't do this. Then in 2 Corinthians, after they've repented, he says, okay, now comfort him and bring him back in, restore
Yeah,
him,
a lot
right?
of people make that connection. They say the person that Paul's speaking about in 2 Corinthians is the person that he was dealing with in 1
Yeah,
Corinthians
I
5.
do
Yeah.
believe that. Yeah. And I think that bears into what Jesus speaks about in Matthew 18. So it kind of flows together. So you have the principle in Matthew 18, then in 1 Corinthians 5, you have basically a case study of it. Like this is in action, right? You have a sin, and it's not just against a person. It is against his father, but it's against the whole church, and it's against God, right? So this is a really heinous sin, and it deserves excommunication, right? And we've had a lot of issues like this. I remember when we were younger, there were people who had issues in regards to adultery and remarriage, right? And the leadership didn't want to deal with it. And so what happens when you have sin and your leadership doesn't want to deal with it? What ends up happening is it permeates in the church. It's like yeast. Jesus always talks about
Yeah.
yeast, right? Once yeast is in bread, it's in everything. It corrupts the whole thing. The whole thing raises, right? And so when there's sin that is unchecked in the church, it will start to permeate. It's like a bacteria starts to multiply, and it becomes a culture in the church. And this is the reason why Jesus was strict about it, and Paul as well. Now, it should be done in a spirit of love and gentleness and grace, but it should be done
Yeah,
nonetheless.
there is that feeling that, because obviously when with church discipline, a lot of people try and avoid it because there's a lot of hard work
Of course,
and you got to
yeah.
get your hands dirty,
And you have
right?
to practice discernment.
Discernment, and sometimes it can try and build a division, like there is a division brewing, because sometimes people don't always hold to what the church is kind of the action that they're performing, rather like hold the person. It's like today's culture, right? If someone's being oppressed, they don't ask why, they just go with that person, right? Because it looks weak and like, oh, I feel sorry for that
Yeah,
person, so
of
on.
course. You want to defend the defenseless,
Yeah,
yeah.
but you don't understand the reason why that person is like he's being judged, right? As the Bible says that we judge the believers. The reason why that person's being judged because he
Because of an action,
committed wrong, right?
exactly.
And I think we definitely need to have some discernment in the sense of that whose side do I need to stick with? Because if my brother's in the wrong and the church is practicing discipline, then I'm not gonna side with my brother. I'll be like, dude, you gotta repent. Get your life together, and then once you're being restored, because part of church discipline is
Is
not
restoration.
to point the wrong, but also to restore the person, right? Otherwise, if we're just gonna point out each other's wrongs, then we're all out of the church. But then you point the wrong to say, this is what you're doing wrong, let's fix it.
Exactly,
Let's
yeah.
get it, let's separate the person from the action. That's something I was taught very early on, when I was growing up in the church, and I had some great leaders. They were a big blessing to me. They said a lot of people, they destroy the person thinking that they are destroying the sin. But then what you need to understand that when you come to the person, recognize that this person is created in the image of God, yet this person did this. Let's deal with the action and let's rescue the person.
That's right.
Don't destroy both, because you're destroying your brother. So that was a big blessing, a good lesson for me to learn. I always would take it, even in the mission field, we did some pastoral teaching and leadership. That was one of the point I said, guys, do not destroy your brother in Christ. Separate the deed from the
That's
brother
right.
and
That's right.
deal with the deed and rescue your brother.
And
That's something
in this
important.
way, you are not fighting against flesh and blood. You're fighting against the spirit
Amen.
behind it,
Yeah,
right? So
amen.
this is one of the things, guys, don't cast your judgments straight away and immediately on those church leaders, because this is one of the things that you don't tend to realize. They hate doing it. Any church leader who is godly and who actually fears God, they have to do this, right? And they don't enjoy doing it. They don't enjoy the church system. That's the worst part of it. No one likes to rebuke. Like they don't. That it's not a
Everyone.
power trip where they love. They love just slamming.
Because we've been in ministry, right? And we would love to go to a local group of people or a church, like brothers and sisters in Christ, and just be like, oh, everything is great today, tomorrow, and forever.
Without confronting sin.
Without dealing with anyone, everyone is thriving in their spiritual life. We would love that, but sometimes you gotta, as we said, like you get your hands dirty, you gotta bring this confrontation, and that's something that we see Paul doing with the Apostle Peter,
That's right.
right? I
That would have
think,
been a hard conversation, that one.
it was, but then he actually called him a hypocrite. He literally said, you're actually falling into hypocrisy, and you need, like, you were dragging other spiritual men with you.
And he did it
Was it
publicly.
Barnabas here?
Barnabas even, and a lot of the leaders in their
So like, not only were you falling in hypocrisy, you
You're
were
causing.
dragging other godly men with you.
And that's the thing with sin. Like I said, it permeates. It's like a bacteria. It spreads to everybody, and it creates a culture of it. And that's why Paul had to do it publicly, because one, Peter was a leader, and Barnabas as a leader was being deceived as well, and so he had to publicly denounce it.
Wow,
Which is,
imagine rebuking two apostles at once. Because Barnabas was an apostle too. So you've got two apostles.
But
That's
there's like
something
the
you put on your resume.
yeah there's a spirit of truth there, but there was also a spirit of love that Paul had. Like he loved these guys. He loved the people that are looking to these guys as well. And so you have to confront. Now, he did it in the godliest way possible in that situation. But not every situation will be like that, because most often you're dealing with members who are not leaders, right? When it comes to leadership, it has to be publicly denounced. Like if your leader falls into adultery or something big like that, it has to be publicly
You don't
rebuked.
hide under the
You don't
cap and
hide.
say, oh, yeah, by the way, he went for a long holiday that he might not show up again.
Exactly. Which
But
is, yeah.
actually, in that example, like the point that I was bringing earlier, Paul made it personal,
Yeah.
but at the same time, he was sharing like truth in an impersonal way, saying we're not under the law, we all get condemned under the law, therefore we need the grace of Christ, and if we could get justified by the law, then Jesus died in vain, and so on. Like he did rebuke him, but then at the same time as he was showing him the truth, right, guiding him back to where he needed to be, it was like more general,
That's right.
impersonal way. And I think sometimes we look at a person and you're like, you did this, you're awful, you're this, you're this, you're this. Instead of saying, that's what you've done, and this is what the Bible says. So what I'm doing is I'm showing the person their wrongdoing, but then I'm leading them to the Word of God. I'm leading them back to Christ. I'm showing them examples from the word to say, this should be your role model. This is your example. This is your standard. Not just, you've done this, you've done this, you've done this. So I don't want to destroy the brother there.
You want to, like you said, you want to destroy the sin, not the brother, because you also don't want to demoralize them to the point where like they feel like they're not up to the standard anymore, you know? Because a lot of people feel like, well, I guess I'm just not cut out for this Christian thing. I'm not cut out for church. That's not the purpose of it. The purpose is, that discipleship, that leading, that, refining by fire, that being molded into the image of Christ. And one of the ways that Christ is molding us into his image is through the church. It's through that rebuke, that exhortation, that encouragement. Like, I know for me, when someone encourages me, I feel so overjoyed, right? You feel like you're thriving. When someone rebukes you, you feel pretty down for a bit, right? But then you take it and you're like, you know what? That's going to edify me. It's going to help me grow. I'm going to take it on board and I'm going to walk further in Christ, right?
Amen.
And you don't get better example of that in ma than in marriage, because I'll tell you. Your wife will always bring up and
It
confront your
is.
spouse.
I mean,
It's
the
edifying. It
yeah.
hurts, but it's edifying.
The good example of marriage is that you're having a person that knows your weaknesses, your secrets, lives with you 24/7, and that's a blessing. To be
Yeah,
honest
of
with
course.
you, marriage is one of the ways that God sanctifies a Christian,
Definitely,
right?
definitely.
Because in church you can you walk into church, you're smiling, you're shaking everybody's hands, you worship together, you listen to the word, you might have a coffee or tea after that, and you go home. No one knows
No,
your life.
yeah.
But then the person that really, really knows who you are is your spouse.
That's right.
And you could be on the defense, right? Where you're always pushing back. No, you don't understand. I'm a guy or I'm a girl. We think differently. You don't need to realize that when the Bible gives you how, like, shares with you how to live your life, it's not about your gender.
That's
Like,
right.
it's for men and women.
Of course.
Therefore, if my wife, says, "Hey, you done this wrong," which she does all the time, especially in the videos, she's like, "Your grammar is bad. Like, you said this word wrong. You said that word wrong." And because my English is not my first language, but I'm like, "Oh yeah, thanks, babe." But then I forget about it. But it's actually true. It was something like, even personally speaking, that you get into marriage and sometimes, like, you're kind of, you're just against each other, and then you realize you're like, wait, the other person
Wants the best for
has a
you,
purpose in saying what they say to me, right? If they're telling me that there's something wrong, they want me to change. They don't want to marry someone and to put them down, unless you have some mental
Bit
problem,
of narcissism
right?
there,
Yeah, but you get married to someone and you're like, that person has a lot to work in, a lot to work with. But then the same thing for me, right? Like, oh, she's there, God's blessings for me to be like, okay, she's gonna put me, she's gonna put that line and say, hey, dude, you're crossing it. Get your life together.
So you take that principle and you're using that exact same principle in the body of the church, in the church government. So you have like church leaders who that is what their role is. It's they see the work of God in your life and they see that there's a lot to work on both in you and in them as well. And so like as iron sharpens iron, one man sharpens another. So we're looking at how each of us can grow to our fullest potential in Christ and to be conformed to his image. And so it does require rebuke. It does require that, hey, I'm seeing you in going in a certain direction. Let's have a chat. Let's talk about this. We're going to confront this part, this thing in your life. Not you, you yourself, you are made in the image of God. This is why we have to confront this thing that's deterring you. It's taking you off path. It's causing you, in the Proverbs it says, don't turn to your left or to your right, just keep straight. That's the idea.
Cool,
They're keeping
cool.
you in line.
Any final thoughts, man, regarding church discipline?
Both for the leader and for the member. For the leader, be very careful for your own soul. If you're a leader and this is, something that God's called you to do, to watch over the souls of your members, be very aware to do this in a spirit of humility, not in pride, with love, with gentleness, with discernment, and with wisdom. So you need to have the wisdom of Christ. You need to have the wisdom that is laid out in the book of Acts. And you see prime examples of it with Paul. You see it with Peter, you know, when they're rebuking certain sins in the Bible and with their members. Do it with wisdom and watch for your own heart that there's no pride being elevated, that this is not a situation where, oh, I'm on a power trip right now, you know, that I just love that power. If that's you, get into business. Don't be a pastor. Don't be a leader. I'm being serious. Like, it's not the place for it. But for the members as well, it does require discernment on your part whether you're in a church that is practicing spiritual abuse, like in the sense that it's legalistic and it's a burden and it's not within the within the parameters of, you know, that spiritual liberty that Christ has laid out. But if you have godly leaders who are in line with God's word and they confront you with sin, don't turn and run. Take it on board and take it as though it is something for your personal benefit, for your growth. And they are there to care for you. I assure you, if they're godly and if you ask for discipleship in certain matters, they'll be there for you. They will walk with you, and as they should. So,
Cool.
yeah,
Yeah,
that's.
great. I just want to say something, man. It's it can be difficult, because as human beings, we try and avoid confrontations, but we do need to understand that it is very beneficial for the church. It's part of God's sanctifying work in our lives, as the body, as His own body, and we can grow from that. That's something that you need to ask yourself, that if I'm not doing it, there is no sanctification, there's no growth, and I won't be able to see fruit in the church, that you see people are becoming more mature in their faith. There's no need for me just to avoid confrontation that I see my brother living in sin, right? So that would be, you know,
Yeah,
what's in
definitely.
my heart.
Definitely.
God bless you guys. We'll see you next time. Take care.